Hi, I've finally gotten to the bottom of one of the most interesting topics for me. This is how React works under the hood. Every day we use hooks, lifecycle, JSX, synthetic events, and confidently talk about the performance of our project. This confidence was generated by excellent React documentation and just a huge number of hours spent writing projects on this technology. But the question is how well we understand what is really going on inside React. How we get 60 frames per second even with a huge number of interactive elements on the screen. That's why I chose React Reconciliation as the first topic for this playlist. As a source of information, I use the official React documentation and an article by Andrew Clark, co-founder of the Redux. He presented similar speech at the React Next 2016 conference. Andrew works for the React core team, therefore there is definitely confidence in this material. All links will be in the description. I would start with a brief definition from the article. Reconciliation is the algorithm behind what is popularly understood as the virtual DOM. Let's try to understand in more detail how it works. It all starts with the basic unit, the node. From them, using a set of render methods, a whole tree of React elements is assembled, which describes the entire state of the application and is stored in memory. And this tree is called current. Then this tree is fed into the rendering environment. In the case of the web, this environment will transform this tree into a set of DOM operations needed to render the current changes. It prioritizes DOM operations according to the urgency of their getting to the user. When the website is first loaded, the rendering environment renders the entire DOM tree, and the user can finally see the first result of all these manipulations and can press the high button. Clicking the button leads to a change in our website, and as a result, a new tree is built. And it is called work in progress. Next, we compare the work in progress tree with the current tree and calculate the difference between them, and only the difference between these trees is given to the rendering environment, and then the already familiar process of turning the difference into a set of DOM operations and prioritizing them. And as a result, these operations will update the DOM tree of our website, and the user will finally see that the bruise greeted him. Oh yes, I almost forgot. The work in progress tree becomes the current tree. This is a fairly general instruction describing the mechanism of reconciliation, but it has many interesting details. Let's try to go through some of them. For example, React core developers have divided the tree comparison engine and the rendering environment into separate phases so that React DOM and React Native can use their own rendering engines when using the same comparison engine that is in React core. The next point is to work with tree. There are several general solutions to the algorithmic problem of transforming one tree into another with a minimum number of operations. However, advanced algorithms have a complexity of the order of big O of n cubed, where n is the number of elements in the tree. If 1,000 nodes were mounted, this algorithm would require a billion comparisons. This is too expensive, so React core developers chose a heuristic algorithm of the order of big O of n. With it, 1,000 nodes requires 1,000 comparisons. It sounds much more attractive. Let's figure out what a heuristic algorithm is. Heuristic is a technique designed for solving a problem more quickly, when classic methods are too slow, or for finding an approximate solution, when classic methods fail to find any exact solution. Roughly speaking, this algorithm is not effective for all cases, and the React core team has made several assumptions to make this algorithm work. First, two elements with different types will produce different trees. Second, the developer can specify which child elements can remain stable between different renderers using the key property. However, in practice, these assumptions are true for most of the cases. For example, in the following code, diff is the parent and the counter is the child. And then there were updates, and we changed the type of the parent element from diff to span, and the child remained the same component counter. Despite this, diff and span are different types, and the entire tree starting from this element will be unmounted, and their state will be destroyed, and then mounted again. Let's think about what it means for us as a React developers. For example, we have a pure component that is responsible for displaying a picture. Perhaps it has some kind of logic, for example, checking for its presence in the browser cache. And if the cache doesn't include it, we need to show a stub picture during the loading state, or maybe some other logic inside. This component is used in many places of the project. For instance, in an avatar, the user has the opportunity to switch his avatar to the editing mode. It means that controls appear next to it. In our case, it is to delete the picture, or to upload a new one. Of course, we expect that when switching from the avatar view mode to the edit mode, the image component itself will not be updated because it is a pure component and we pass the same props to it. But it's not so simple. We need to wrap the image component in an additional diff in order to do absolute positioning the controls on top of the picture itself in the corner. As a result of switching the mode, the algorithm begins to revise our components from top to bottom. The first was a diff, and it remained. Then there was the image component, and now again some kind of diff. So there was a change of types. This means that the past image component is completely removed from the tree. It means component will on mount is called from the previous instance, and then the tree is rebuilt, which means that a new instance is created for the image class, and render method and component did mount are called, but we didn't count on it at all. To fix this problem, let's just remove the extra diff. Let's say we figured out how to implement it without the diff, and add only controls in editing mode. In this case, it will really work. Our image component will not be mounted and unmounted every time. But then I decided to experiment and added controls, not under the image but above it. It is small changes, but again the problem returned with the fact that the image component was unmounted and mounted when switching the mode. And it sounds logical. We again compare from top to bottom and see where the picture was, now the controls. So it was defined as a change in types, and again everything went wrong. At the same time, if you change the code a little and bring it to the form with single return and use a logical operator, then everything works. It works as now the place is reserved for Boolean, although it is not displayed to the user or for the controls, but the position of the image component is always the same. But let's return to the case with two returns. To solve this problem, we can use the second assumption. The developer can specify which child elements can stay the same between different renders using property key. It means if we specify the key property for the image component, then React will know that the position of the component has changed, and your code will work again as you originally expected. And of course, the first thought was to try to use the key and wrap the editing case in an additional diff, but it doesn't work. Key works only within the same depth level of nodes. Knowing these assumptions, you can easily solve the problem with strange behavior at first glance. But do not forget, thanks to this assumption, React was able to speed up the algorithm for traversing the tree from the order of the big O of N cubed to the big O of N order. And it is very important. The next very important thing that was mentioned in this video is the prioritization of DOM operations. This is really a very important and very complex thing, because just think about it. We want the application not to lag, as in games we expect 60 frames per second for a smooth picture. To achieve it, you need to update the frames every about 16 ms. Now imagine that the user has made a 240 ms interface update. To prevent all this from starting to lag, the React core team decided to split the interface update into smaller DOM operations, the so-called units, and prioritize them. Because the hover animation of the button seems to be a higher priority than updating data in a block that is not even in the viewport at the moment. Therefore, React sorted the tasks for you and showed the animation in the first frames and postponed some less prioritized tasks for the next frames. To implement this logic, the React team uses two methods: requestAnimationFrame for higher priority tasks that need to be performed literally in the next frame, and requestIdleCallback for low priority tasks that can be performed while the application is idle. More details can be found at the links in the description. As you see, the main difficulty of such a task is to prioritize these small DAW operations. You can even find a separate package in React repository called Scheduler. If we open it, we will see a field called Scheduler Priorities GJS, which includes priority constants which we discussed earlier. As you can see, there is an idle priority constant. It means this kind of task is performed while the application is idle. There is a low normal priority and others. All this allows you to determine the order of DOM operations. And if we go back and open the scheduler.js file and scroll a little, we will even see the timeouts of these priorities. The numbers look pretty high, as much as 10 seconds of waiting for low priority tasks. And let's scroll a little lower. We see the timeouts returns depending on the priorities of the task. But I'm not sure if this code is currently used in production or if it's just some drafts, since we see prefix unstable on many exported methods. And if you search globally by the repository, you will see that priority constants is duplicated in several places. Probably, active work is still underway to find the best solutions. The last point, which I would like to talk quite a bit, is about the history of the React. In version 16, the long-awaited project called Fiber was finally introduced into React, which made it possible to plan which operations with the DOM need to be performed now, which can be postponed a little, and which are no longer relevant at all and cannot be performed. And as a result, the user gets his cherished 60 frames per second. This algorithm is, of course, much more than just a React Scale scheduler. It started as an experiment and was written from scratch, and after 2 years it was merged into the repository, which personally made me very happy. I remember there was even a own site with countdown to the release of Fiber was introduced. What's it all about? This is an example where simple migration of your project to a newer version of the library can improve your project's performance. Therefore, it is always worth keeping an eye out for new experiments from your favorite libraries, and perhaps you can benefit your current project without spending a lot of money on it. If you liked this video, I will be grateful if you press like button and subscribe to the channel, because this is not the last video, and many other useful things await you on our channel. Bye bye.